Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business this morning is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. Our next item of business is a joint evidence session with the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the UK Climate Change Committee on financing a just transition, ahead of an anticipated chamber debate on the committee's two just transition inquiry reports. I welcome Professor Keith Bell, Mitigation Committee Member, UK Climate Change Committee, and Professor Graham Roy, Chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. As I've mentioned, the committee have undertaken two inquiries, one into Grangemouth and one into the North East and Moray, which have recently been published. And we know that we've seen the confirmation of the oil refinery in Grangemouth planning to close next year. Could the witnesses maybe give us an overview? We're interested in how we finance the just transition, and the evidence that we heard during the inquiry was the significant resources that would be needed in order to achieve this. At the moment, there are, given the scale of the challenge, there's fairly modest commitments from both Scottish and, I would say, UK governments to this at this point in time. I mean, I don't know if I come to you first, Professor Bell, and maybe give us an idea on what the kind of levels of investment that are required and where we are at the moment in terms of being able to give that investment.
Yeah, so the investment clearly is significant. We're talking in the order of billions of pounds per year, albeit spread across different sectors. Depending on the sector, the split in terms of the numbers for UK as a whole or within Scotland will, of course, be different. The last analysis that we did for the Climate Change Committee was as part of our sixth carbon budget advice, which is a few years old now, but we are redoing that analysis. And so when we come to early part of next year, we'll have some new numbers to be able to share with you, among others. A big question, obviously, and I'm sure Graham will come to this as well, is about how much of that investment is public and how much is private. I think it's worth recalling that investment in renewing our capital stock is essential anyway. Whether it's industrial equipment, vehicles, home heating systems, whatever it is. Net zero and the kind of transition to a low carbon economy depends on the next time any of those investments are made, that a low carbon option is chosen instead of a high carbon option. And with many of the technologies at the moment, the physical kit, the higher carbon option at the moment looks cheaper. However, over the medium to long term, the cost difference is not so significant, actually, when you take into account operating costs. So the obvious kind of example would be in terms of anything that uses energy, electric vehicles versus combustion engine or home heating systems. If we get the pricing of electricity right, then over the medium to long term, actually, electric vehicles should be cheaper, even when you take into account the capital cost at the beginning. Heat pumps should be cheaper. But there's a few ifs along the road there. And of course, there is the issue about, who funds that capital investment at the beginning. So, I guess the sort of main point I want to make is, what's the increment over the investment we should be making anyway? And also the kind of benefits that the opportunity we have when we make those investments to make things better. So an obvious example is in terms of homes. Too many of our homes in Scotland are not well enough heated, they're cold, damp. It's disruptive to change a heating system or to improve insulation. So, heating systems have to be renewed at some point anyway. It's relatively easy to replace a gas boiler with another one. But we should be taking the opportunity to upgrade, both in terms of moving to a lower carbon way of doing it and improving the performance in terms of heating. But your question, that requires investment. Who's going to pay for it? There's a certain part of the population who are able to pay, and other parts where the financing of it is a real challenge. So that's very much on the demand side. On the supply side, in terms of, for example, low carbon sources of energy, the industry is there, has proven it's there, ready to invest. It's ready to raise the finance. It can raise the finance. Of course, they're going to recover their costs over time through bills. Because electricity is now, new sources of energy in terms of electricity generation, low carbon generation, are cheaper than high carbon sources. So, as I say, if we get the market structures right over the medium to long term, we will see the benefits of that. So that cost recovery through bills actually should be, you know, affordable. And, you know, some analysis that we've looked into over the kind of system costs of electricity in the coming kind of one or two decades, that average cost, including not just production, but, you know, large parts of the network and balancing and so on, would be lower than the wholesale electricity cost was last year.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, there's a kind of timing issue there about the financing and then cost recovery.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, that's a long answer to your, what's supposed to be a brief introductory question.
And it's introduced a lot of issues for us to pick up on as we go through this morning. If I come to you now, Professor Roy. So, yeah, the similar kind of question, you know, within the two inquiries, one big issue has been finance, and we know there's pressure on public spending at the moment, and that's kind of within this year and within possibly anticipated the next few years. But the plan we're looking at is really kind of 10, 15 years. All the targets that have been deferred to already around electric car usage or heat pumps are longer term targets. So I don't know if you have reflections on the kind of immediate challenges we face, but also looking forward. You know, we're in a difficult situation at the moment, but we anticipate that not to last forever. Our targets are longer in the future. How do we achieve those and how do we finance them?
Well, first of all, thanks very much for the opportunity to come along and speak with you. I think there's a few things in that, and we published our first fiscal sustainability report into climate change, which was our first kind of dipping our toe in the water in the Fiscal Commission, starting to think about these issues about how does the public sector finance the transition that we need to make in climate change. I'd say there's a couple of things which I think are really quite interesting from a fiscal perspective, from a Scottish budget perspective, and it builds on some of the things that Professor Bell has spoken about. So the first comment I'd make is that I can't think of a policy area where the interdependencies and the complexities between devolved and reserved areas are as significant as they are in somewhere like net zero. And that really matters on the funding implications, because you think about the investments that the Scottish Government will need to make in the transition to net zero and the commitments that are needed within the public sector budgets. Some of that will be determined about the funding that flows from Westminster, both in terms of the scale, the form of that funding, but also coming to your point about the timing, about when does that investment flow through, because still a significant amount of the Scottish Government's budget is dependent upon decisions that are taken at Westminster, and that's particularly true on the capital budget, and we'll maybe come back to that about what's happening to the capital budget, projected to happen to the capital budget over the next 5 years. The second area is obviously through the taxation element, so the devolved tax powers that the Scottish Government has. And what's crucial in there is, essentially, on income tax, is high-value jobs. So particularly around a transition away from jobs which particularly pay relatively high levels of income tied to oil and gas and whole supply chain there. How do you transition through to high-value jobs that continue to pay income tax, high levels of income tax revenue, through to the Scottish budget in that context? And then there's the commitments about what's the priority within spending. And we've seen in recent weeks real challenges in essentially the Scottish Government reprofiling expenditures and prioritising different elements of spending in there. So how, when you face these really quite difficult short-term challenges, do you continue to make the investments and prioritise investments in climate change and tackling net zero? So I think there's big questions around funding. So what's the flow of funding from the UK government? Big questions about taxation, but also big questions about spending commitments in there. And the final comment I'd make that wraps all of that up, one of the conclusions that we came to in our report that we did in March was that there's still a lot of uncertainty and lack of clear information within budget processes around commitments around tackling climate change and transitions to net zero. And there are opportunities, particularly with the climate change plan, the adaptation plan, but also with the regular Scottish budgets, to be much clearer in setting out how commitments, different commitments by the government, are helping support that transition to net zero. So I'm sure there's lots in there that we'll be able to unpack.
Because we saw some of the challenges, because we looked at the North East and Moray, the £500 million the government committed over 10 years, because of the situation with financial transactions, they have reduced that. So when it was announced, you would think it would be £50 million a year, and I think we're only at £75 at this point in time, just maybe an example of a commitment that's made, but the practical difficulties in delivering it is
Exactly. We also did some calculations in our fiscal sustainability report. We just looked at mitigation and the potential additional investment that might be needed in this in the devolved public sector. And we were calculating with lots of different assumptions, but you would need around £1 billion a year additional spending on average over the next few decades. But if we take that in the current context, that's based on a projection of the capital budget falling 20% in real terms over the next 5 years. So there's a real, there's two pressures there. There's the additional commitments, as Professor Bell was saying, as you're spending that capital money to look at the low carbon option. But at the same time, you're also potentially facing cuts to your capital budget. And that just makes that these decisions all the more difficult.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm going to bring in Michelle Thompson to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Good morning, everybody. I'm so sorry I can't be there in person. I think I'd like to just carry on that theme, Professor Roy, and just dig a little bit more into your...
We have a problem with connectivity for Michelle. I'll just give it another few seconds, see if we can... So what I'm going to do is invite Murdo Fraser in. I'll come back to Michelle after Murdo.
OK, thanks, Convener. Good morning, professors. Just to follow up on the line of questioning from the convener in terms of who pays for this, just to pick up something you said, Professor Bell, I thought was really interesting around the transition from gas boilers to heat pumps. And just a small illustration, I visited a new housing development in my region just a couple of months ago. And, you know, nice new build houses, very high spec, heavily insulated. And I had a conversation with a house builder about the heating system. They are all having gas boilers installed. And I asked them, you know, why are you not putting in heat pumps? And the answer was, our customers don't want them. Because, one, there's an additional cost, I think they said, of £8,000 per property to put in a heat pump as opposed to a gas boiler. And at the market they were in, the customer said, we're just not interested in doing that. So I'd be really interested to get your perspective on that. But let me just ask my broader question, maybe come back to that, because it seems to me around this whole issue of net zero, you know, it's very easy for politicians like us to say we're going to set targets that are 10, 20, 30 years in the distance and then pat ourselves on the back and say how well we've done. The practicality then becomes when you try and implement measures such as heat pumps, and the public say, wait a minute, we're not prepared to pay for that. So the question of who pays for this, therefore, becomes absolutely crucial. Professor Roy was talking about the situation with the public finances. Government's going to struggle to pay for it. So what is the scope, what is the opportunity for private finance to come in? And do you think there's enough being done in the financial markets to bring in models, opportunities, products that can help fund this?
Yeah, really, really good question. Let's pick up the last bit first about the kind of financial sector and the kind of what sort of products are there. I thought there was some really interesting stuff actually in the heating buildings bill that was being consulted on for this parliament about especially kind of at the point of sale of homes and what responsibilities were placed there. The expectation would be, I suppose, that kind of mortgages that can help to fund upgrades would become available. And then so an example of regulation driving the development of the market. So not leaving things entirely to the market. So I think there's real potential there. Obviously, that's the point of kind of resale. The example that you gave was of new build. And again, I think there's potential for regulation to play a really important part there. But at the same time, you know, of course, you know, if the builders are saying that our customers are saying we don't want it, it's very difficult. It's easy for them to come back and say, well, we've just done the obvious thing. I mean, it turns out it's also easy for them to do it because they can find the people that know how to do it. I mean, £8,000 sounds to me a bit like the upper limit if it's new build and it's designed all in the right way. You know, the heat pump itself and the associated kind of you know, hot water cylinder and whatever, I'm not sure are that expensive. But anyway, there is a challenge about the workforce and finding the people to do the installation. The evidence from things like climate assemblies, you know, that happened in Scotland and through UK Parliament, is that when you sit down and explain to people how these things work, and that they do work, and that actually over the medium to long term, links back to something I said earlier about electricity bills versus gas bills, we get that balance right, we get the market design right, actually your running costs are going to be lower. So it depends a bit on the kind of the size of your home and how much energy you're using and all of that. But actually, the net cost is pretty much zero, or maybe even a saving. But that doesn't get around, as you were implying, you know, the kind of the upfront financing issue. And I would like to think that if there is a kind of growing market for this, then building societies and whatever will respond to it. I've given evidence they respond in ways in the past, but I think it does take something to get it moving, you know, bootstrapping the whole process. So there's a public communication piece about, yes, these things work. They work in other countries. You know, this is not new technology, actually. Potential for, got to realise the potential for lower bills, and everything kind of, you know, gets moving from there. So it doesn't need to be a burden on taxpayers paying for all of this, although there probably still is a role, I think, for taxpayers. And then it comes back to something that Graham was talking about, you know, the kind of the priorities and the choices that are made. How much public money is made available, for example, for low-cost loans or for grants for certain sectors of the population?
That's right.
Yeah, I mean, a couple of points I would make. So I think you make a fair point about how do you translate targets into actual action? And one of the recommendations that we've made in our climate change work, but also in our most recent data needs request, is recommending that the government is much clearer about the actual spend that they're making towards transition to net zero, both in terms of climate change plans and documents, but also in terms of the budget. So at the moment in the budget document, there's relatively broad brush assessments about whether a spending line is contributing positive or negatively to climate change. But there's nothing in there which says we're spending X amount of money every year on this action, and this is explicitly targeting net zero. And I think you could be much more transparent there. And then you can actually just take a step back and look. These are the targets that we have got. These are the ambitions that are being set. Do the decisions in the budget actually stack up to meeting the targets and ambitions that are set there? So there's actually a lot more that could be done just by simply improving transparency that you could then track through. And then there's the usual issue around, that's what you might say in a budget document, but do you actually spend it? And tracking outturn and being able to track outturn. So you can look and say you're not making the progress you said you would, because actually we can see you're not spending enough. Or crucially, the UK government is not spending enough as well in those areas. And on the point about financing and opportunities there, I think there's a couple of things. There's obviously a big debate at the UK level about the fiscal rules that we have and the potential constraints that's putting on levels of investment, and does it make sense to think about existential threats such as climate change as just a normal day-to-day investment, or do you need to think of it in a different way? So there's a big questions there which will need to be resolved at the UK level, which will then have implications for funding here in Scotland. I think there's the point about leverage. So how do you make sure you're leveraging the amount of public sector spend in a way that is most effective about getting in the private investment? Some of that's regulation. Some of that's about potentially looking at innovative finance opportunities and funding elements in there. There's also a basic question about prioritisation. So, again, that comes back to my point about transparency, that ultimately this is about making decisions. But if you are committed to going to net zero on the timescales that are being set out, then you have to be really clear about we're prioritising some things over others, and that, in the current fiscal climate, is going to require difficult choices. But one final comment I would make around all of this is that I think about your point about how do we engage consumers and how do we engage the general public. I don't think we do enough to illustrate what's the opportunity cost. So what is the alternative scenario? And the Office of Budget Responsibility have been quite clear on this, on fiscal sustainability, that unmitigated climate change would be disastrous for the public finances. I mean, they talk about a number of nearly 300% debt to GDP from essentially the damage that will come through climate change. So I think there's something about reframing the conversation, that particularly when we talk about things that these are investments that are needed, you know, that it's not to say that this is a, you know, that if you don't do it, everything is fine. No, no, no. There's then going to be significant costs that are going to come from adaptation and the damage that will come from climate change. So reframing the conversation, I think, is really important.
Okay, a couple of follow-ups, if I may. Just on that last point, I think that's, in terms of where the public are, I think that's really interesting. Of course, the issue for people is, and I hear this pushback all the time, people say, well, even if we get to net zero tomorrow, if the rest of the world doesn't, it's not going to make any difference, or make very little difference. And therefore, you know, so the challenges we face, whether in Scotland or the UK, are exactly the same challenges we're seeing faced in other Western economies, where everybody's on the same trajectory we are. Everybody's pushing back on targets. Everybody's going slower because of the fiscal and economic challenges. So trying to win the public over against that backdrop, I think, is much more challenging, is it not? But maybe come back to the question, Professor Roy, that put Professor Bell, about financial products. I mean, do you think the financial products are there? You know, we've seen, you know, over the last couple of decades, lots of different schemes come in, things like, you know, the Green Deal, and all these different schemes seem to come and go, and people really don't have any sense of, you know, if you came to me tomorrow and said, put in a heat pump, you know, there'll be some scheme to help you fund it, I wouldn't know where to start, because, you know, these schemes change with such regularity. Is there a need for, A, certainty in terms of what's on offer from government and public sector, and secondly, are the financial products there?
Yeah. So on your first point about the challenging, you know, I get that, and I can understand why that the pushback is there. I guess the really simplistic answer, and I know it's not it's perhaps not reassuring in a sense, but what we do is look at what the Parliament decides to do, and if the Parliament decides that Scotland should meet its net zero obligations, and that's its role in wider global society, but it's also good for Scotland, both in terms of the long-term economic benefits, which I guess we might come on to, but also it is the right thing to do for Scotland in terms of its nature and environment, then essentially our role in the Fiscal Commission is to accept that, take that as a given, and assume that essentially you'll do that really difficult bit, and then we look at how whether or not the politicians are and the government are making the decisions there. On the point about innovative finance and things, I think you're entirely right. So there's an argument for certainty, and that's got to be really crucial there. So when people are making decisions, whether it be individual households, individual consumers, or businesses as well, that there is certainty about what the products are, and what they how long they were available for, etc., etc. But to be fair, I think part of the issue is that a lot of these markets are still quite new and emerging, and you go back through key points in history around, you know, changes in the industrial landscape, changes in the system, and it was in the same boat. Things were really in flux. But I think there is an onus about trying to get through that period as quickly as possible so we can actually get the innovative financing and things there. And there are lessons in the past. I mean, we've obviously used financial transactions effectively across the UK to make loans and investments in different aspects of public policy. There are good and bad experiences from PFI, PPP, and lessons that have been learnt from that, again, where you can leverage in additional investments. And I come back to that point about, I think there is a debate about what do we mean by essentially the public sector commitment and indebtedness into investments in climate change, and actually do we need to rethink that in a way where you're making investments which aren't just for the next 5-10 years, and that's usually the timeline we might think a public sector investment we want to see a payoff, but this is actually something which is for 50-100 years, and we sometimes, I don't think we assess these appropriately at the current time.
I might add to some of that. The point I made earlier about that, you know, it's investment. It's not just investment for net zero. It's investment for improving or replacing your capital stock, whether it's, you know, a building, a vehicle, industrial equipment, or whatever. You know, we're kind of arguably underinvested anyway as an economy over a number of years, and we're arguably seeing the fruits of that, or, you know, rather poor, you know, harvest. Yeah, the point about you know, making the case, you know, I mean, Graham makes a great point about, you know, the opportunity cost. What's the alternative? And yeah, I hear it as well, as you can imagine, you know, about, well, if other countries aren't doing it, what about us? You could look at that two ways, you know, other countries are definitely not going to do it, or it's much less likely for them to do it if we don't do it. So we've got to show that we're committed. And for the size of our nation, I think the evidence is that we do kind of, yeah, punch above our weight in terms of that international influence. And new government down in Westminster is making some positive noises in that respect just in the last few days. So, you know, let's see how that goes. And other countries are facing the similar sort of issues. So with the similar questions about what's right for future generations. And I think that's, some good moves forward. We still, I mean, in many respects, still need to see delivery. But I think one way of framing this whole discussion is about, and it does seem to cut through, is what's right for your children? What sort of world are your kids going to face? What are we going to leave to them? That has a much stronger emotional impact, perhaps, than sort of technocratic arguments about megatons of CO2 emissions and whatever that we might see now. Apart from when we see the disastrous effects of climate change now, you know, the extreme weather impacts, you know, flooding or extreme heat or whatever. So making that connection in people's minds about, well, this is a consequence of that. There is a big mission here. And this is where, you know, I think, again, Graham makes a great point about whether these sorts of, you know, the extra investment to deal with climate change mitigation and adaptation, the need to adapt is inevitable because climate change is already a fact. This is a kind of, is it seen as a one-off or as a regular thing? Well, certainly it's a one-off thing we've got to address and to see it, again, in those terms of investment for the future.
Just one more follow-up for me, maybe Professor Roy, to yourself. Do you have a view on how effective Scottish Government has been to date in terms of drawing in private investment, for example, through City Region Growth Deals, Scottish National Investment Bank, the Green Investment Pipeline? Has that overall been successful, or have there been weaknesses in that experience?
Yeah, so we wouldn't express an opinion on whether it was successful or otherwise, but I think the broad point that you make is that I think that it's those types of things, those types of more innovative types of funding opportunities, I think, are really important. I mean, the point about city deals, I think, is really interesting, because the one thing that is quite unique about the city deals is that collaboration between the UK governments and the Scottish governments. And I think on that, you can see that some ones which have been more successful than others. And that comes back to my first point that I made, that I can't think of a policy area where the interconnectedness between reserved, devolved, but also the fiscal powers of both governments interact in a way which is completely different from something like health, where it's, you know, it's pretty much spending is devolved and you get an amount of funding through the Barnett formula, and then you're kind of left to it on every aspect of the investment needed on a transition to net zero. There's issues about interaction between targets, interactions between spending responsibilities, interactions between legal responsibilities, interaction between tax powers. That I think that things like city deals and things like the collaborative, you know, effective ways of, or potentially new ways of collaborating between the two governments in investments, I think is really important.
Thank you.
To bring Gordon MacDonald in for a supplementary, and then I'll come back to Michelle Thompson.
Professor Bell, I just wanted a bit of clarification about something you said earlier on. You said if we get the market design right, we should see lower electricity bills. But electricity is traded on the wholesale market. And currently, if you look a year ahead, prices are 5% higher than they currently are, and Hinkley Point has been guaranteed by the UK government a price of £92.50 per megawatt hour, which is 12% higher than the current spot price in the wholesale market. So what do we need to do to change the market design, and how do we go about it to get these lower bills?
Yeah, I'm glad you saved the easy questions up for. Yeah. you're quite right to refer to the wholesale market. So the wholesale market, broadly speaking, the price is set by the marginal unit. And as you know, that's gas. And as you know, gas is very expensive right now. So this is one of the opportunities, actually. The periods of time in which we would be using gas as the marginal unit as we increase our low-carbon electricity production, will become fewer. So, you know, I think there was some modelling that a colleague was doing just the other day, different scenarios, even for 2030, instead of, sort of 90, 100% of the time gas is setting the price, be reducing to, say, 50% of the time. So the rest of the time you can benefit from the low-carbon stuff. The Hinkley C deal, I mean, that's 2012 prices. If you look at it in today's prices, it's even, you know, more. What's the approved term for big numbers? Is it eye-watering? Is that right? Look to my economist friend here. So, you know, it's a lot. But it's in terms of the energy that it produces as a part of the overall energy mix, it's a small part. And the way the kind of the price is structured, that should not be the price setter for the wholesale market and the spot market as a whole. So, yes, there's a price that needs to be paid for that. But the difference it makes to the average is small. And the good news then for newer things like the wind farms onshore and offshore, even with the relative slight price increase in the most recent auction, those prices are still clearing at much lower levels than the sort of gas, you know, whatever that would be. So the market design is a lot about how that sort of wholesale market is set up and the extent to which those marginal prices, what's setting them and how they then flow through to what the consumer ends up paying. And the other part, I think, is about the legacy costs. So there was a time, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago when renewables were expensive. And to get that industry going in this country and in other countries as well, policymakers made the decision to, in effect, subsidise them, albeit recovering, in our case, those costs through bills rather than through taxation. So those legacy costs are still there. And I now stray onto Professor Roy's territory a little bit in terms of the kind of, you know, good taxation and bad taxation or whatever. But, you know, normally you would be taxing the bad thing and, you know, kind of rewarding the good thing. So in this sense, fossil fueled electricity production is the bad thing and low carbon is the good thing. So why are we putting all those legacy costs on electricity bills rather than on gas bills? Now, we have to approach that very carefully because there'll be distributional impacts. Different segments of society would kind of benefit or suffer to different extents. So while that looks like, to me, a very sensible thing to do, we have to look at it as a package of measures to ensure that we don't have unwelcome consequences in terms of the impacts on the fuel poor, for example.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Michelle Thompson to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Good morning. My second apology for not only not coming in person, but then freezing when I did. If any of this has been covered, please just do say so. But I just wanted to finish off the item, Professor Roy, in terms of the existing fiscal framework. I think you alluded to earlier that there was an anticipated 20% cut in capital for the Scottish Government's budget over the next 5 years. And you also make the very worthy point that the fiscal framework fundamentally is not set up to deal with this kind of challenge. Have you managed to, or indeed been invited to, have any discussions with the UK government so that they can understand that? Because clearly you have with the Scottish government. Have you done so? And do you think that it's understood that it simply won't be fit for purpose when we're looking at this type and nature and scale of funding?
On the point about capital budgets, you're right. So the current plan for the Scottish Government's capital budget is essentially to see a 20% real terms cut over the five-year period that we did our forecasts back in December. And that's largely from the previous UK government's decision to essentially freeze capital budgets in cash terms. Now, we obviously await a UK budget in October, where the new Chancellor will set out UK government's plans around capital investment, and that will then generate Barnett consequentials, positive or negative, which will then feed through to the Scottish budget, which I guess comes into your point about the fiscal framework. So the most significant part of the Scottish budget is still the block grant from Westminster. And that's particularly true for capital. So essentially, the Scottish Government's capital budget is largely determined by Barnett consequentials and the ability for the Scottish Government to borrow on top of that. But the vast majority of that comes through the Scottish Government's, the UK Government's capital consequentials. So that's a broader point, that anything that the UK Government decides to do on capital investment to support transition to net zero, you know, above or, you know, increases or decreases, has a knock-on effect to the Scottish budget, and that makes it then easier or harder for the Scottish Government to then invest in capital elements there. And that gets back to my general point about the complexities around the process and the interactions and the interdependencies between the two governments. In terms of the comment about engagement with the UK Government, I mean, we, as you know, our main remit is to support the Scottish budget process and to engage with the Scottish Parliament. We do speak to UK government officials to talk about our work, but we wouldn't have a role in advocating or recommending any changes to the fiscal framework. That's ultimately, the fiscal framework is ultimately an intergovernmental the relationship between the UK government and the Scottish government. So we wouldn't go any further to recommend any changes to that. That would be ultimately for the government to decide.
Okay. And I know you made the comment, and again, apologies if this came up while I was offline, about the critical dependency between Scotland and the rest of the UK, and that, frankly, the UK can't get to net zero without Scotland's contribution, particularly around land and peat. If you could give some more flavour of that, or if you've had the chance already, then just let me know and we can carry on.
Yeah. No, so that's a really good. It's really grateful you answered that. You asked that question, because that's one of the things that we cover in our report, is looking at some of these interdependencies between Scottish and UK government decision makings and what they might mean in terms of funding and financing. And the point about land use is really interesting, and the investments needed in tree planting, in restoring peatlands. And the like. And we know that the UK needs Scotland to punch above a population share in order for the UK to meet its net zero targets because of geography. You know, we have 30% of UK land mass. We have around half of all trees. We have about 70% of peatlands in the UK. So the UK essentially needs Scotland to invest in land use, reforming land use, in order for the UK to meet its net zero obligations. But one of the really interesting things about the way the fiscal framework works is that to the extent that the UK make investments in land use, Scotland will get a population share of that investment. But clearly that population share is less than the geographical share. And that's a really good example of one where the funding arrangements potentially would put an additional burden onto the Scottish budget, onto the Scottish budget, simply because of geography. And that's one area where, again, in our work, it just shows that this is a fiscal risk for the Scottish budget, that if we want to make these investments for Scotland to get to net zero by 2045 and the UK to get to net zero by 2050, there will be an additional fiscal risk in there for the Scottish Government.
And that the scale of that fiscal risk is such that they're unlikely to take it, given the lack of long-term projections over funding, I imagine. Just a throwaway comment that the convener made at the start of this, she alluded to, and I think her words were, a relatively modest further commitment to Grangemouth in the light of the recent announcement. In terms of what you're understanding from a fiscal contribution that's required, there's two sets of 10 million on the table because 80 million is for the Falkirk growth deal, i.e. the wider district. What's your thought about two sets or 20 million from both governments in the light of what is possibly predicted with the closure of the refinery? Is that enough?
So we've not looked at that in any detail. We wouldn't go down to that level of detail in terms of the appropriateness or the level of that expenditure. We wouldn't go into that detail. I mean, the general comment I would make around that is that we're seeing played out in real time the challenges in the transition between the moving away from the industries that have benefited Scotland significantly in the past, both in terms of actual jobs and investment, but also in terms of tax revenues too. into, well, what might be that future be? And that transition is going to be challenging to get right. And then there's a really important role for government in there to manage that transition. So, but whether that number is sufficient or insufficient, yeah, we wouldn't go into that detail or comment on that.
Last week comment is that, as you know, I was very complimentary about the fiscal sustainability report because I felt that discussions thus far, without factoring in the wider kind of fiscal considerations, were doomed to failure because of some significant lack of funding and obviously the public and private capital and so on. But do you think I'm right in that? And therefore, as a result of your report, are you seeing more of an understanding that the how we get there can't be totally fleshed out until we understand some of the both the opportunities and the risks around the funding? Am I right?
Yes. Well, given that you gave us a compliment for our report, then I can return the compliment. And I do think you're right. I mean, one of the things that we've tried to do more broadly with the fiscal sustainability work, not just on climate change, but on demographics too, is to make the point that so much of the debates that we have, and we've seen that in recent weeks as well, is debates about funding next year, or in recent times, debates about funding this year. And it's very short term and it's very much focused upon essentially the here and now. But on issues like demographic change and crucially around climate change, these issues are huge. And the potential risks to the budget are really significant. And we've never had a really significant debate about this in the Parliament beyond the margins. And I think that the work that the Finance Committee does to support our work here, the push for a debate in the Chamber around fiscal sustainability, I think is really important. That'll be a really important moment in time for the Parliament to essentially look at, lift its eyes up from the day-to-day budget to look at the longer term issues. And I think in terms of levels of understanding, I've been quite encouraged by, since we've published this report, by the number of people who are really interested in what we've done. The proof will come, actually, do we start to see the improvements to things like the climate change plan, things like the budget documents, which actually translate the investments that are being taken into actual numbers which are really transparent to let you see and assess whether or not progress is being made in order to meet these fiscal sustainability challenges.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
If I could just ask a couple of questions before I bring in Willie Coffey. If I come to Professor Bell first. So Professor Roy's talked about Grangemouth has been played out in real time. And you'll know that when the committee published our report, the news on the closure of the oil refinery to the timescale we're looking at now, that wasn't in the public domain, and we didn't know that when we published the report. And we are hoping to have a chamber debate on the two reports. Do you have views, I suppose, just reflecting on... I think everybody, most people, accept that the oil refinery doesn't have a long-term future. It's the pace of the change that we're seeing that is difficult. Do you have reflections on the current situation that you want to share with us?
I think you hit the nail on the head that it's the timing that is a real challenge to deal with. I think, broadly speaking, in terms of the changes to where the jobs are, the number of jobs and the kind of value of those jobs, as Graham was alluding to earlier, there's both bad news. There's bad news, but there's also good news. The good news is that. According to our analysis in the CCC and many others as well, the net zero transition will bring a net gain in the number of jobs. Of course, the challenge is exactly when they come relative to the ones that disappear and where they come as well, the location. And the third bit actually maybe is the easier bit. I mean, they're all challenging, but the easier bit is of about the kind of the transferability of skills. Now, I would say that's the easier bit because a lot of the skills are directly transferable, actually, between, for example, the oil and gas sector and the renewable energy sector. So, project managers, lawyers, environmental scientists. There's a lot of need for skills like kind of welding, civil engineers. Other things are kind of less obvious and would need a bit of retraining or reskilling. But we've got the means collectively. I mean, I wouldn't put this all down to government. I think industry has a responsibility to step up here as well to provide investment in training and education, you know, in terms of funding college places, in-house training, support for people while they're retraining. So, you know, we can do something about that. It's kind of within our means. Like I say, the harder bits are about the timing and the locations, and they're going to lead to uncertainty. There's uncertainty certainly in the shorter term about, you know, the wages that you're going to find. So the oil and gas sector in general still pays pretty well. There is wage inflation going on inside the renewable sector. You know, I'm seeing this in my kind of day job at University of Strathclyde, you know, where you know, I'm educating my colleagues, electrical engineers, and they're getting much better salaries now. I mean, maybe, I don't know what percentage, but anecdotally, you know, significantly more than even a year ago. So that might be then attractive for people to kind of say, right, okay, now's the time for me to leave the oil and gas sector and take up a job with one of the renewables developers, for example, or electricity networks. But then there's a question about location. You know, they're not necessarily all in the same places. On a kind of Scotland-wide basis, again, some reports I've seen suggest that there's actually good news on that, but that report didn't go into the sort of spatial, you know, deepest great spatial granularity about, you know, the northeast versus the central belt versus the freezing or whatever, you know. So there is a need for more information there, but you know, the kind of the potential pipeline for developments of wind farms off the Scottish coast, and now we're starting to get new onshore wind farms and where they might be located. You know, there is a lot of those jobs have the potential to be in and around Aberdeen, for example, but we don't yet know. And I think that's the kind of big, big challenge.
And before you have raised some of the issues that the next members will be asking questions around, but before we leave the issue of financing, if we just have a kind of final question around the issue of private finance and what the barriers to that might be. And we know that, you know, America had a big fund in order to encourage renewables, and Europe launched a big fund, and the UK was seen as being a bit behind. Obviously, we've had a new government now for the last few months, so we're at a different stage. There could be different changes coming down the line. But do you think, what are the barriers? Do we have sufficient kind of policy clarity? Do we have governments that look like they're open for business? Is there enough financial levers to encourage private finance if we compare us to other countries or other?
It's a good question, and as you say, it's a picture that we would expect to be changing in the coming months. There's some lots of noise about GB Energy, for example. I'm not quite clear exactly what that's going to be doing yet. Imminent.
There has been for a while, but
imminent's a good word, isn't it? Yeah. Or in due course is another way of doing it. Yeah, we can look at our thesaurus out and, you know. So how much that will kind of really make a big difference, I don't know. What's the amount of money that's been talked about? £8 billion, which in the scheme of things, in terms of the overall investment in renewable electricity generation, is not a huge number. But on the other hand, this most recent auction round for Contracts for Difference, you could argue is a success. You know, it's cleared at kind of decent levels. It's got a decent amount of capacity. Is it enough capacity relative to what we're trying to get to by 2030? Probably not. But, you know, we can hopefully have a chance to do it again next year and ramp that up. Clarity in all these kind of, you know, the auctions, for example, which I think have generally, apart from the previous one was not a success, but generally speaking have been a success, getting them big enough, and that clear trajectory, I think, is probably one of the keys to the longer-term confidence among the developers. Because what they then want to see is investment in the supply chains and investment in the skills. So they need to be, they've started investing in the skills development, I think, too late. They're starting to kind of wake up to the lack of people. So, yeah, there's a kind of a discussion to be had around the best way of doing that. But investment in the supply chains, who's placing the contracts? So the contracts there big enough, long enough to encourage, you know, new equivalents to the Sumitomo cable plant. What's the next one in terms of whether it's blades or electrical machines or fabrication, cables, etc.? Mm-hmm. You know, that's has a potentially big win in terms of jobs, linking back to what we were just saying about the transition out of among other things, out of oil and gas into renewables.
Mm-hmm. And then, Professor Roy, is there anything you want to add around what the barriers to private finance might be? And I think Professor Bell's answer did kind of reflect, you've talked about the interconnectedness between the UK government and the Scottish government and how it needs to be a shared venture. Is, in terms of barriers to private finance, is there more we could be doing in Scotland, or are we kind of waiting to see what the UK government do in terms of helping in that field?
Yeah, there's a general point which I think Professor Bell touched on earlier, was just about levels of investment across the UK in general. And if you look at one of the reasons why the UK economy has underperformed relative to key competitors is it's a distinct lack of business investment. So we're actually in the bottom quartile of OECD countries for business investment. So there's a, I think there's a much more bigger structural question about lack of investment in the UK economy that's not just limited to net zero. And that gets into questions about business model, about incentives, about predictability, and a whole variety of different things. So I think the point about working between the UK and the Scottish government, I mean, I think this comes back to the questions we were chatting about, things like city deals. But again, if you think about net zero and the potential opportunities in there, there's issues around innovation, there's issues around investment, there's issues around public and private partnerships in there, there's issues about skills, there's issues about regulations, and all of these things are spread across both governments. And, you know, thinking about how the two governments work collaboratively in order to achieve the ambitions in net zero, and Michelle Thompson made the point that we've made as well, is that ultimately it's a shared endeavour between the two governments, because the UK needs Scotland to get to net zero and get to net zero more quickly in order for the UK to get to net zero, and vice versa. And so that kind of collaboration in a way which is much more significant and needed than in any other area of devolved policy.
Thank you. Willie Coffey to be followed by Lorna Slater.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wonder if I could drag us back to heat pumps for a wee moment or two, and Murdo led some questions there in the whole subject of heat pumps and why we're significantly off track. There's probably a number of reasons for this, and when I talk to my own constituents, they tell me these things, that the quality of the information they get is perhaps not enough, the assurance that they get perhaps isn't there. The cost of it at the moment, where electricity is much more expensive than gas, is a factor. So there's a number of reasons why they're not making the transition switch, despite some reasonable efforts to put some grant money on the table and so on and so forth. What do you think will begin to make the significant transition for people, particularly in private residential homes in Scotland, where the huge problem remains, to persuade people to make the shift? What is it we need to do? Do you think there's a role that Scotland's councils could play here? And I think a House of Lords committee made such a recommendation. Imagine quoting that in the Scottish Parliament. But the sensible suggestion that Scotland's councils could take a leading role in this, if they were able to do so, because people will possibly trust advice from their local authority, particularly if they were involved in the transition process as well. So could I just maybe ask for your views on what would be the key ingredients to get the kind of transition ramped up that we really need to do to try and get anywhere near these targets?
Yeah. Lots of good points, good questions. So I think local authorities do have an important role to play. It seems that some local authorities are trusted more than others, but in general, I think they have a really important role. The potential for coordination, support generally through housing associations for social housing as a kind of thing that's already underway, and as far as I understand, in many respects already successful. Planning, local energy planning is a kind of big thing, a kind of giving the signalling. Where they lack, I guess, ability is to deliver on those plans. So either through kind of statutory powers, or the way they can kind of direct private investment, or to sort of say, right, well, we're going to do a heat network here in this zone, that's the right answer. And then what are the commercial models around that? Because it's a big upfront investment, but promises to pay back. So getting enough kind of anchor load into that, as an example. And local authorities seem like the obvious party to sort of coordinate some of that. The idea of kind of doing programmes of retrofit you know, a street at a time. And that points to, I think, another thing that can help to bring this about is people are much more accepting of things when you know someone who's already done it. And they can tell you all the experiences. They'll say, well, this was a bit tricky, but this actually worked, and it's great, you know. And I'm on that journey myself, you know, so I'm, you know, trying to get this stuff done and trying to navigate the sort of information that's out there and who are the trusted suppliers and all that sort of thing. And then I think the question was raised earlier about, you know, the, whatever grant or loan schemes are available and how they change and access to information. We've got to be much more consistent and much clearer on that. There's a lot that Home Energy Scotland leaves a lot to be desired in terms of their website, how it's laid out, what information is there. I'm keeping a long list of stuff I'm going to be feeding back to Scottish Government officials when I've finished my own journey along this. But I get encouragement from talking to friends or colleagues who've already done it, and they say, oh yeah, this worked, or watch out for that, or whatever. And I think that will get a mushroom, if you like. And of course it depends on everything being done in the right way, so people have a positive tale to tell. And then, as you said about the, you know, the relative prices of gas and electricity, I mean, you know, very rough rule of thumb, the coefficient of performance, you know, the kind of how much heat you get out to the relative electrical energy you put in of a heat pump, 3-ish, and the performance varies a bit, and some of the new ones are a bit better, but that ratio is similar to what you'd expect in terms of, you know, getting payback of the ratio of electricity price to gas price, where you can start seeing a net benefit rather than a net cost, which links back to something we talked about earlier about electricity pricing. So I think all of those things together, and I guess you have public examples of, you know, hey, this worked, I've done it, and then as the market grows and it becomes less hard, less difficult to find a good supplier, less contractor to do the kind of specification and installation, then again it all kind of, I think, becomes hopefully more of a virtuous circle.
That sounds really encouraging, but do you still think that we're going to achieve the kind of ramping up because of that, those impacts? Like the evidence base, for example, would be crucial. People to be able to speak to other people who've done it and to ask them, how much does it cost you per month to do this? That's the key for me. And possibly also bigger incentives, I'm afraid. I'd have to say there has to be greater incentives for people to make the switch that makes it really worth their while to do that. And along with that evidence base, Professor Bell, that might be the key to changing this. Would you agree?
I would tend to agree. Yeah, I would certainly. I think, as I said earlier, I think there is also a discussion about those who are able to pay in comparison with those who are less able to pay. And that's something, again, I'm kind of navigating my own experience to do with that. But it's an important discussion, linking back to something that Professor Roy has mentioned a number of times about those kind of choices. If you've got kind of constraints decided, you know, politically on what the budgets are, how are you going to allocate them? What are you going to prioritise? And then what's the rate over which that you want to achieve these sorts of transitions, which comes back through to discussions about, you know, what carbon budgets we're going to set within Scotland. It's got to be kind of, they've got to be both ambitious and deliverable. Ambitious in terms of we've got to play our part, you know, for the global transition, but it's got to be deliverable, and then it's got to be backed up by these sorts of, you know, very, you know, concrete, although it's got to be low carbon concrete, but, you know, very, you know, firm action. A target that's set and then missed undermines credibility and confidence about whether we're really serious about this in the first place. So we've got to be serious, and we've got to deliver.
Your journey and complete it. Can we get a video of you on Home Energy Scotland's website telling everybody how successful?
If they want me to do it, I'm happy. Yeah, I'll do it.
Fantastic. My other question for you was more general about the regional impact of just transition and how we watch out for the regional imbalance being perhaps negative in some parts of Scotland. And you yourself, Professor Bell, you were talking about where will the jobs be? You know, where in Scotland will they be? How will we monitor that? Do you see a risk that parts of Scotland could be left behind because of this journey that we're making? And how do both governments try to make adjustments to try and ensure that that doesn't happen and everybody can share in the journey to net zero?
I do see a risk, but I think we also need greater clarity. And Graham has mentioned this a number of times about greater transparency and clarity in respect of, you know, budgets and what they're going to be spent on. But I think it also applies in terms of where we expect the jobs to be, what kinds of jobs in what areas and at what time. OK, the what time depends on all sorts of other assumptions you've got to make. So I keep being told, for example, in respect of the energy sector by a body called Energy and Utility Skills, that they've got all the data, that they know how many people are needed in different kinds of roles, whether it's project managers or cable jointers or professional engineers or whatever. But I haven't seen that published. And as a university academic who teaches electrical engineers, I'd quite like to see it, you know, to have some idea of, you know, it helps me to tell, you know, prospective students and their families, right, hey, these are, these are huge numbers of jobs. There's great demand for what you're going to learn on this course, or alternatively, another course. We need to develop something else. A similar thing in FE colleges. So we've got to be able to see the data. I do have some degree of hope about the kind of regional spread. You know, homes are everywhere, and they're going to need this sort of conversion work. Some of the work will just be done once. You know, replacing your radiator system, for example, you do that once, and a heat pump will last for whatever, 15, 20 years, and then you have a new one, right? Okay, so there's a kind of a one hit. So some of the work won't be kind of ongoing. Work in terms of, we talked about it, mentioned it already, you know, peatland restoration, afforestation. We're hearing in the CCC that there's a shortage of people and skills to deliver that. And, you know, those are in rural areas where, you know, normally we worry about lack of jobs. Changes in the agricultural sector, you know, in terms of the management of land, moving to, in some places to some extent away from livestock, not completely eliminating it. I don't think no one serious is talking about that, but towards, cultivation of the land, husbandry of hedgerows, trees, enhancing biodiversity and so on. These are public goods. And we've been accustomed for decades, actually, in terms of paying agricultural subsidies. So these are pretty substantial budgets already. So I think, I mean, Graham will have a better idea of the numbers, but there's a large extent to which these are redirected and not necessarily an additional fiscal impact. But, you know, maintain or possibly even grow the number of jobs. But anyway, the main point I want to make is about the need for greater clarity, that kind of data, so that you can only plan to support retraining, college places, whatever, if you know where these jobs are going to be. And then you have to, OK, we're also going to make some assumptions about the rate at which you want them to be delivered.
So, moment in terms of the government knowing this and perhaps even the college network knowing what's required.
So people tell me, certainly in the energy sector, apparently EU Skills pass on their data to Skills Development Scotland and then work on behalf of, to some extent, the Scottish government. But it's not, the numbers aren't going further yet. I've been encouraging them to share their data, and I'm expected a similar story in other sectors.
Okay, anything, Professor Roy, to add to that?
Yeah, so I mean, I think everything that I've certainly seen talks about the opportunities, the net positive benefits overall in terms of jobs and employment in the long run from the transition to net zero. And I think EY did some work for the Scottish Government as part of its just transition work that did different scenarios, and you see in many of these instances being net positive, particularly in the long run. The challenge is, of course, is how do you get there? And that's where I think we have to be upfront and honest that there is going to be some really difficult challenges. We're seeing it played out with Grangemouth at the moment. But how do you transition and support people through that transition? And there will be regional implications of that. And we don't have to look far in Scotland's history to see when we got that transition wrong and badly wrong. And we're still living with the legacy effects of that through deindustrialisation and communities across, particularly West Central Scotland, where we now have more jobs than we had back in the 70s and 80s. We now have higher incomes on average back than where we were in the 1970s and 80s, but communities have been really badly affected by that transition at an aggregate level, which is positive, but certainly doesn't feel like that at a local or a regional level. So I think there's a lot that we can actually learn from our relative recent history in Scotland about how we support that transition. And there, I think there are opportunities. As Professor Bell said, I think the transition isn't just about moving into low-carbon energy and the high-skilled jobs and value there. These are potential job opportunities right across all regions of Scotland in terms of the housing stock, in terms of investments that are needed to transform every aspect of our economic model. There are obviously opportunities in parts of the economy that have maybe been cooler in the past, so particularly in rural areas, particularly in other areas where there maybe haven't been the opportunities, but there'll be jobs coming through. But there is a challenge around how we transition, particularly in the northeast, away from these very high-value jobs that exist in oil and gas or are tied to oil and gas into other areas. And we did some work as part of our recent fiscal update where we looked at the obviously our interest is in income tax and the funding of the Scottish budget. And what's quite interesting is if you look at even just back the last 10 years, the kind of average income tax in Scotland was around about £3,000 less than the average income tax raised in the northeast of the country. And in total, that was worth about £700 million additional income tax revenues from that northeast premium. And that's declined significantly over the last decade. So that premium is only worth now about £350 million. And it's because of, you know, the shakeout that we're seeing in oil and gas in terms of the relative decline, the relative slower growth. And that's, we've seen that, you've probably heard us talk about that relative underperformance of Scottish tax revenues relative to the UK since devolution. And a large part of that is about that weaker performance of employment and earnings in the North East. So this isn't just a question, the transition for the North East isn't just a question about jobs and opportunities in that region. It actually has quite significant fiscal implications for Scotland too. If you get it right, then there's lots of high value jobs, lots of opportunities, lots of new investment that can then power everything going forward, but it's not guaranteed, and that's why the importance of the work around that transition is going to be absolutely fundamental.
Thank you for that.
Some progress. So Lorna Slater to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I've actually got two questions. The second one's come up, but I'll get into them. Professor Roy, I'm delighted that you have highlighted the cost of not taking action, because that is something that frustrates me continually, this idea that who's going to pay for it? Who's going to pay for it if we don't? It's much, much worse. Professor Bell, you had highlighted an issue or brought to our attention about that some of the changes we need to make aren't going to cost the public purse. I agree with that. Not all the transformative policies we need need to cost the public purse money necessarily. And I worry sometimes that within this kind of larger debate, there's a tone of, oh, it's just too expensive. We can't do it. Net zero is too expensive. And I policies such as, you know, removing subsidies from aviation, giving farmers the same amount of money but for doing slightly different things, demand management charging, so that's congestion charging, workplace parking levies, carbon land tax, putting in that regulation on heat pumps and insulation to level those playing fields, those don't cost the government anything. And yet we have such difficulty moving those things forward. So I wonder if, well, either of you, but maybe Professor Roy, have any comment around what kind of political consensus we need there? What's the difficulty with moving forward with these policies, even though they don't actually cost the public purse anything?
It's a good question. So, I mean, we wouldn't comment in the Fiscal Commission about specific policies, but I can make some general comments there. I mean, I think you hit the nail on the head around what's the opportunity cost, and a lot. So much of this conversation is framed as this is additional investment that is needed, as though doing nothing has no fiscal cost. And I think that's where the work of the OBR is really helpful, where you can essentially, you know, just track what the additional increases in adaptation and damage would be, and the shock, to the disruption to businesses, the disruption to households, the investment they need to go into responding to flooding and damage. And we saw that, was it Storm Babbitt recently, the millions of pounds that had to be invested as a good example of that. So I think that importance of reframing the conversation is really important. I think your broader second point is starts to get into where I think, coming back to the point about innovative finance, I guess is about how do you innovatively spend the money that the government has. I mean, the government spends £50 billion a year, so that's a lot of money. So how do you think about what you're spending on, but also how you're incentivising, you know, good behaviours with the money you're spending, or disincentivising poor behaviours. So thinking about, as you alluded to, things like grants to farmers, things like support for businesses, things like how you're investing your social housing budget or your housing budget more generally. I think there's a lot in there which we've not really explored too much, because quite a lot of the conversation has been about spending on net zero as though it's like a spending portfolio. It's one thing that one bit of the government does, rather than thinking about it, well, actually, how do you think of everything that government does as being much more supportive about transitioning to net zero? And the final point I would make about that is I think that the conversation we've had in the UK, and certainly in the kind of economics profession in many ways, has almost kind of isolated out climate change and net zero as being a separate kind of discipline, a separate thing that we should look at, rather than thinking about, you know, we need to remove carbon from our economy, which has built our economy over the last 250 years. We need to do that quick. And that's not just one sector. That's absolutely everything. So if you start with that mindset, thinking about everything that government does with that lens about how do you incentivise the right behaviours to push towards net zero, I think has got to be the way forward. I come back to the point about transparency, though. Within a government budget, how can you track that? How can you scrutinise what the government are doing to give you the assurance that the spending announcement the government has put forward is actually spent? So the point about outturn is really important. But then secondly, is actually delivering on the transition to net zero, or it's not? And we don't actually have that information just now.
I don't know if Professor Bell had any thoughts on that question.
Well, I think Professor Roy has put it all very, very well. And I'll just kind of re-emphasise that last point about delivery. You know, we are supposed to be in a delivery phase right now for so many of these things. And in terms of monitoring what we're doing in Scotland, again, we need the data to see what's happening. We need the data to be kind of prompt, well-maintained, transparent. And that gives a chance for policymakers to kind of reflect on measures that might not be working or not as effective as they were expected to be. So the measures are going to be put there in the first place. They should be accompanied by detailed analysis to say what they're expected to deliver. Then we can monitor whether they do. I mean, the best will in the world, not everything's going to be designed perfectly and not everything will turn out as you totally expect, but then give the chance for that feedback and updating of policy as a result.
Thank you. So my follow-on question is along those lines, and I'm going to pick up from where my colleague Michelle left off on the question of how do we get there. And I suppose for me, a bigger question is knowing where we're going. Because we know we're not going to get to the 2030 targets, but we still must get to 2045. And I think there isn't a political consensus about what 2045 looks like. So it's even, to me, less about how we get there than what are we trying to get to? Have we agreed what transportation looks like in 2045? Do we know what all our buildings look like? Do we know what our industry looks like? Do we know what our agriculture and land use looks like for 2045? Can we agree on where we're trying to get? And I think the question about clarity is a really, really relevant one, because I don't think there has been clarity over which industries have to contract. We hear a lot about growth, but not all industries can grow. Aviation can't grow. You know, other high carbon industries cannot grow. They must contract. So some clarity, but being honest, saying a transition means some industries contract, some industries will grow, and equally some regions of Scotland may either not grow or may contract, whereas other regions will grow. So I'm interested in your commentary on both those points about how do we get a vision of where we're going to? Do you feel there is such a vision, or do you feel we need to develop that? And is that information out there in terms of what needs to grow and what needs to contract? And if it is out there, how do we make sure it's getting that clarity and presentation it needs?
Giving some kind of sense of the pathways and the ways of delivering net zero by 2045 in Scotland, 2050 for UK as a whole, that is something that we do in the Climate Change Committee. We model and analyse for all sectors of the economy, pathways all the way through to 2050. So, for example, we're working at the moment on producing advice on the 7th carbon budget. So although that's some years into the future, you know, 2038 to 2042, we're re-evaluating how we get to that period and whether what we've said before, currently we're in the 4th carbon budget period and there's, you know, the legislation in between, Is that still the kind of right path? Is it still deliverable? What are the economic consequences of that? Costs and benefits both. So we're redoing all of that. And we will be publishing that, sort of the first half of next year. So that is there for people to scrutinise, publish a lot of detail. They are still scenarios. They are still based on best available information today. Some things will be changing relative to the last time we went through this exercise, which was for the sixth carbon budget. Some things have got cheaper. So electrification of industry, for example, looks like a better option now relative to, that might lead to, for example, less hydrogen in and around industrial sectors. Not eliminated, that's still got a part to play. We'll have a better idea of, costs of wind farms and of electric vehicle costs coming down. So we could be more we could be bolder on that, if you like, and saying, this is actually a net benefit over the medium to long term in terms of cost of moving around if you assume the same number of vehicles. But there's also choices. This is the reason why there are scenarios. There are still choices which are not ours to make as the Climate Change Committee. They are yours to make as politicians, as policymakers. For example, the extent to which you might want to subsidise public transport or development of cycle routes. What difference will that really make to emissions and people's ability to get around? What happens in terms of industrial transformation? A lot of things are at the UK level rather than the Scottish level. But if we're decarbonising industry, does that make a difference in the short term to the costs of products being sold on international markets? Does that then inform a need for things like carbon border adjustment mechanism? Can we align that with the rest of Europe, and so we don't kind of suffer so much by being outside of those, and so on and so forth? So, I think there is quite a lot of clarity. They need to always update it in light of new information. But I suppose the translation of what that means into back to the sort of everyday choices for businesses, households, individuals, and for policymakers, it's an ongoing kind of challenge and mission to communicate that. I think the things that need to be decided now, and the things where we can afford to wait for better information, and also in between that, the things that we need to do in order to get better information. So in terms of some of the technologies, what do we invest in terms of demonstration projects in order to keep the optionality there, being clear, so making that investment, being clear about when we need the information and then what you're going to do with the information when you get it. So it's a multifaceted thing, as I'm sure you realise.
And does that feed through, Professor Roy, into the work that you do in Scottish Government in terms of saying, OK, we know these industries must contract, we know these regions of Scotland are not going to be able to grow, but this other region is? Does that feed through?
So I've not seen anything that does the detail in terms of then looking at projecting forward about exact scenarios in terms of what might happen to sectors and regions. But I think what you're suggesting, I think that's the sort of thing where, as we get, as Professor Bell was saying about the delivery phase, about saying, like, actually, this is... This is what the long-term trajectory is suggesting, that we need to track to meet 2045, and then this is where the investment opportunities are. But I think one of the comments I would make is that so much of what we see around the kind of strategies around the economic aspects of the transition to net zero, for good reasons, for fear of being criticised or potentially undermining the arguments in favour of net zero, are always about the positive bit, but they don't get into the issues about, we need to have a significant conversation about the parts of our economy, the sectors, the big industrial plants that we know are not going to be around into the future. And that's not going to just happen because of policy, but actually, oil and gas is a really good example of that, is irrespective of your view on oil and gas, we're in the twilight years of the North Sea as a basin to extract oil and gas from. So whether you agree or disagree with extraction of oil and gas, this transition is happening, and it will happen quickly over the next 10 to 15 years. So I think that kind of really hard, honest conversation about what we do in there. And I come back to the point I was making to Willie Coffey. We don't have to look far back in Scotland's history to look at times when we got this badly wrong. And we didn't have that really frank conversation about these industries are not going to be around in the next 10 to 15 years. And how do we support that transition and support those communities for the significant opportunities we know exist, but they're not guaranteed that these individuals will get them.
I could just make a very quick addition to that. I think what Professor Roy said about the oil and gas sector in the UK, that is going to shrink anyway. You know, the production is going to reduce. Even if you granted new licences and try to develop new fields, the total production is reducing, regardless. And I would link back to one of the first points I made about the framing of all of investment for the future, whether it's because of net zero or because we just should be investing anyway, and we can build in the benefits of adapting to climate change and reducing greenhouse gas emissions while we're at it, then, you know, we've just got to make the case for investment.
Thank you, Convener.
Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. And can I thank Professor Roy for highlighting the North East premium in terms of his previous answers. And I think we all need to take note of that North East premium. And in so doing, we should also ensure that there is no regional contraction, that we get this right for every region of Scotland. We have seen elsewhere in the world major investment in the move to net zero. We've seen $234 billion in the United States in terms of the new Green Deal. We have seen our investment here in Scotland in terms of the North East and Moray Just Transition Fund. We had a situation whereby the Labour Party promised £28 billion a year in terms of green initiatives, which has contracted quite dramatically. And that investment, I think, will drive forward, or should drive forward, if they are there, that change. But I want to concentrate on jobs and data. You said earlier on, Professor Bell, that we require, and I quote, clarity of data. And the Climate Change Committee itself published analysis which suggested that there's the potential to create between 135,000 and 725,000 jobs across the UK by 2030 in the new low-carbon sectors. Can I ask about that data, assumptions that you may have made in reaching that, and how accurate do you think some of that data is?
So you can ask. I wasn't involved in that particular piece of work, so I will have to get back to you offline in terms of the sources. The sources are cited in the report, as we always do. We don't hide anything. We'll be leaning upon other bits of work to a large extent, and again, you know, we'll be kind of scrutinising those to make a judgment about the credibility of them. There are lots of reports out there that do point towards a net growth in the number of jobs. The fact that there are a lot of reports, and they come from, you know, what generally credible parties, so industry parties or well-established consultancies or whatever, gives me some confidence that the general picture is true, that there is going to be a net growth in the number of jobs. But I guess part of your question is that you would like to see greater clarity and detail, and so would I. Because, as I said earlier, if we're going to be planning for retraining, reskilling, if individuals are kind of planning their own futures, they want to have a good understanding of, as I said before, when the jobs are arriving and where they're arriving. I mean, some relocation is inevitable, I think. I mean, people do that. It happens. Not everybody. And some people have got kind of greater means to do that than others. It depends on, you know, stage of life, what, you know, kids at school and all that sort of stuff. But it's not unusual. You know, there was an influx of people into the Aberdeen region through, you know, the 1970s and 80s when the oil and gas industry was growing. I mean, they came from somewhere else. So, you know, this is always been, you know, forever a fact of economic life. But we need to make it as easy for people as possible. And as I say, the more granular data, the better for the interventions that governments, local, devolved national governments can make in terms of supporting the planning and industry as well, so that they can have a better idea of where they're likely to be able to pick up the people with certain skills and where they can't, and where they need to step in and invest on their own part.
Thank you. You talked about planning there and getting this right, and quite frankly, I'd like to keep the people that Aberdeen in the North East has gained over the piece. In terms of your report and in terms of other discussions, there has obviously been major concerns around about the mismatch between the timing of the switching off of old industries and the switching on of new industries. And although I think we all recognise that oil and gas is in its twilight years, as Professor Roy said, it's not at an end. And we will require oil and gas into the future. Of course, what we should be endeavouring to do is to make sure that we're also creating other jobs at the same time as oil and gas jobs diminish. But in terms of that planning, in terms of that policy, do you think that in terms of some of the most recent announcements from the UK government, in terms of the Chancellor's statement, that provides the planning and the policy to get this right? Or is it a case that that's been driven by current fiscal situations rather than getting it right for a just transition? I'll maybe go to Professor Roy in that one in the first instance.
Mm-hmm. Well, the good thing is I can comment on Scottish Government fiscal decisions, and I can we don't tend to comment too much on UK Government decision makings in there. I think
but decision making has an impact on the Scottish Government's fiscal position.
Exactly,
Professor Roy.
Exactly, and that was going to be my point around. Obviously, we wait until October the 30th for the decisions by the UK government in terms of what they are spending and what the Barnett consequentials will be there. And that will come from the points that you're making around what is the UK government, the new UK government's assessment of the fiscal position of the UK public finances. And part of that determines about what they're in power, is looking at what they see as being the structural challenges and opportunities within the fiscal position they've inherited. Secondly, though, it's also back to that point that we made earlier about what are the fiscal rules that they set. Now, that sounds quite geeky and technical, but that is really fundamental for determining the fiscal headroom that the UK government has got to be able to spend. We will then come, as we've in the discussion with Michelle Thompson, comes crashing into the Scottish budget, particularly through the capital budget and their decisions on capital, because so much of the Scottish budget's dependent on that. And that's what becomes really important. Can I just come back to the first point that you were making just around data on labour market and things? Because I think there is a real challenge about, you know, really robust data that we have on what do we mean by the net zero economy, and also the oil and gas economy as well, because so many people who work in the sector then live in other parts of the UK and overseas. So tracking job numbers, even in oil and gas industry, isn't as easy as perhaps you might think in other sectors. And then there's a big question about what do we mean by a low carbon job? What do we mean by a green job? So success in Aberdeen, for example, over the long term will be people who have the skills and are working in a sector that might be oil and gas, transitioning into a sector that is low carbon economy or green economy. But the other thing as well, and coming back to your broader point about Aberdeen, is that you know, Aberdeen is a strong economy that doesn't depend on oil and gas. So part of the success for Scotland, but also Aberdeen, is actually continuing to grow the broader economy and to take advantage of not just a first mover advantage that, that Aberdeen has in oil and gas, but actually it's our most export-focused region within the country. It's also one of the most skilled regions within the country. It's also one of the most successful parts of the country in securing investment and innovative and inventive parts of the economy. So how do you get that skills base to then take advantage of the new sectors, not just in low carbon, but across the economy, that will be really vital to the future?
Thank you, Professor Roy. You're selling Aberdeen very well there, better than some of the folk from the area who often take a much more pessimistic line. Thank you for that. I want to concentrate on that planning, that policy, that data, Professor Bell, because I think it's extremely important that we get this right. You said earlier on that in terms of transferability of skills, which Aberdeen in the North East is awash with immensely skilled people, you've said that skills development has come too late. How do we change that at a UK level, but in terms of investment, and also getting it right at a Scottish level, so that we manage that just transition, so that we're not putting folks from the oil and gas industry and other industries on the scrap heap, as happened to the miners a number of years back. How do we get that right?
So there's a the situation we have at the moment is there is a lack, what I'm being told by people in the renewables sector and the electricity network sector, who I talk to very often, there's a lack of people. They're really struggling to hire people into all sorts of roles, but I think especially technician and engineering roles. So in that sense, the training and the kind of development of them is lagging. There's a question about the sort of, even if you put the courses on, are they attractive enough? Do people understand and see that there is a good career there? We might offer places at my university, but are people going to apply to come and study there? So there's a bigger piece than just making the training places available, although that's a big part of it. I don't think it's solely the responsibility of industry, and I don't think it's solely the responsibility of government either. Government for many years has had a big part to play in terms of education and training, and I think we'll continue to do so. The evidence, as I say, of the kind of difficulty in hiring people, as I mentioned earlier, there's a wage inflation going on in some of these sectors. Now, are those wages attractive enough and obvious enough that people know about them to attract people out of existing sectors, existing jobs, into those new jobs? And is retraining required on the way to do it? And how is that retraining funded, especially if someone needs to go to a course for a year and they're not earning in the meantime? So those are things that I think industry needs to step up to, but also government in terms of maybe a shared investment. Back to the point about planning and clarity, how much of that are we talking about? It's a difficult thing, obviously, as we've touched on many times in this discussion this morning. Difficult thing to talk about extra spending by government when already there are severe constraints.
But in terms of that, and both of you have highlighted this before in terms of answers to questions, this is not necessarily just investment by government, but investment by the private sector to attract the right people. But if we don't have the planning there and getting that absolutely right, then they are going to be much more averse in making those investments, are they not?
Absolutely, yep. I mean, maybe we should try to be clear about what we mean about planning, the extent to which things, in large part of private investments are somehow directed or centralised. We've got to be a bit careful about that. In the energy sector, there is a move towards more centralised strategic planning, something that the UK government has set out in terms of what the new National Energy System Operator is supposed to be doing. So really important to see what they say in setting some of that long-term direction, both for generation development and networks. But at the other end of the scale, in things like we've touched on, like heat pumps and so on, and electric vehicles, there are other sorts of government levers to give confidence and clear signalling So maybe that's kind of a key part of it as well. And the signalling and the planning then also needs to kind of take into account, you know, the various scenarios and assumptions. But if there's a strong lead, I think, from government, then there can be greater confidence, put those right signals in place that they will be delivered. And then the private sector, I'm confident, will come in and invest.
So clear signalling, and I think, again, a very important point, is it sometimes difficult for clear signalling to be given here because of often diverging views from the Scottish Government versus the UK Government? And is it often difficult to give that clear signalling when there has not been, in some areas, the moves from government that would actually attract investment? So let's give an example there. In terms of hydrogen production, the lack of movement from the UK government in terms of dealing with regulation for storage and transportation of hydrogen is obviously an impediment in terms of investment. So that clear signalling that you talk about, it's not there. How do we get that better?
The Climate Change Committee is on record as asking for clarity on the development of a hydrogen economy, you know, certainly in terms of sort of making things like low regret decisions. You know, where is there, you know, for example, what's the minimum need for low carbon hydrogen? There are many scenarios that you could look at in terms of how big it might get, but there does seem to be a kind of a strengthening consensus that there's at least a need for some. And, you know, the UK government is working on business models around how you get that moving. So what we can do is encourage them to move faster on that and come up with some of those sorts of signals.
Thank you. Professor Roy, in terms of that divergence, in terms of those differences, and I think you highlighted one earlier on in terms of investment into peatland and forestry, for example, how do we ensure that there is clear signalling from both governments? And does the UK government have to allow flexibility in terms of the fiscal framework to ensure that we get more bangs for our buck in terms of the move to net zero UK-wide by investing in Scotland so you can achieve some of these things that the rest of the UK can't?
Yeah. I can return to my answer to Michelle Thompson, which is that ultimately the fiscal framework's for the two governments to sort out, and we kind of sit on the sidelines and then comment on the basis of how that operates. I think your general point, though, and I'll come back to...
You won't be able to comment on that either.
Yes, yeah, we don't comment on that either as well. So, but there's a general comment I'd make around this point about, you know, if you take a step back, the decision-making that is needed in net zero, given the devolution settlement that we have, has so many complexities in terms of interactions between the two governments. You mentioned hydrogen as a really good example of that, but you can look at that in terms of all aspects of surface transport. You can look at it in terms of economic development, innovation policy. There's all the work around investment zones, for example, in Aberdeen, the whole work around the Aberdeen City deal. So the complexities and interactions there are really crucial. As an outsider looking at that, there's a question about how coordinated that is, how planned is that? So is it a green freeport or is it an investment zone? And actually, how do you take a step back and think about what do you need to work collaboratively on over the long term? And that gets into big questions about the effectiveness of intergovernmental relations more broadly. And I think the only comment I would make is that that could probably be improved.
Thank you very much, Professor Roy. I want to take the opportunity and decade anniversary since the independence referendum to talk more about the other pathway. Convener, thank
Brian
you.
Huttle. Brian Huttle.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Professors. I wanted to really dig a wee bit more into maybe the preparedness of the Scottish labour market to accept the opportunities that are potentially available there. And I think there's any doubt that every single person in this room you know, from every single party want to get to the same place. We just have a different way of getting that. I think my frustration lies, we know there's a shortage of engineers across, you know, all sectors. We know there's a shortage of tradespeople. I think, you know, in terms of data, when the Scottish Government made the target of having 1 million homes retrofitted with heat pumps by 2030, the construction industry said we're 23,500 tradespeople short. We need them by 2028 to hit the 2030 target. I think really my question to start with would be around the educational environment and how when governments set targets like that, there's no route map. There's no way in which, you know, we say right in that case we need X, you know, we need 23,500 tradespeople, we need X number of engineers, and therefore in our FE sector, in our education sector, in our retraining, this is how we're going to deliver that. Professor Bell.
Yes. Well, yeah, I mean, absolutely. That's what we should be doing. We should be giving that sort of information. Government is the obvious, seems like the obvious party to gather the information together from different sources and articulate what that is likely to mean for training places. Where it needs to be, I think, a broader discussion, as I've mentioned earlier, the funding of those places is I don't think it should solely depend on government. I think industry needs to step up there, and does step up. Incidentally, you know, there's a lot of stuff that is funded. There's a lot of investment that parts of industry make to in-house training as well. There are other parts of industry that don't and just sit there and poach people that have been trained by somebody else. So that is actually kind of a bit of a disincentive to investing in, you know, the in-house training colleges and courses and so on. There's also, I think, again, I mentioned this earlier, we have to communicate the opportunities to people who might want to sign up to these courses, that this is an exciting place to be. Hey, I don't know if anyone's watching who's got a son or a daughter thinking about going to university and come and do electrical engineering. It's great. There's lots of fantastic opportunities. I would say that, wouldn't I? But no, it's true. It is absolutely true. And Scotland supplies a lot of the electrical engineers for the whole of the UK. There are quite a lot. I mean, we talked about mobility of people. There's a lot of our graduates that move down south and are getting, you know, senior jobs in places like National Grid and whatever. You know, great for them. Great opportunities. So, but it's difficult. It's difficult for small and medium enterprises. And there's a lot of parts of the construction sector of very small operations. They're exposed to a lot of uncertainty and risk. So I think especially where, you know, those sorts of employers need particular help, you know, where I don't know whether it's the form of loans or whatever, the individuals taking time out, whether it's an evening class or, you know, a month-long course or whatever it is, they're not earning while they're doing that, as I mentioned earlier. It's very difficult. Big industry can potentially support that when they've got the confidence that the jobs will be there and the future revenues will be there. That's an investment on their part. They can support through their own, effectively their balance sheet. Smaller businesses, it's much harder. So that's where I think we might need to be targeting a bit more thought and effort.
I'm glad you mentioned about the risk to sort of the small and medium sized companies, because it's very evident that if you're a heating engineering company in Kilmarnock, which I met with, they'll train somebody, takes maybe 3 or 4 years, and then they graduate, and then just down the road, there's much bigger engineering companies at Prestwick Airport who just took them in. So where's the incentive for that heating company to do that? And I think it also speaks to certainty in the marketplace in terms of these people want to expand. I think that's the frustrating thing. Every company, this committee went to the Prestwick Airport, and every engineering company we spoke to wants to expand, but can't get the engineering, the staff to do so. So and that sort of leads me to my next point. I think Kevin Stewart alluded to this around creating the opportunity before you close the other opportunities down. Because what actually happens is they don't end up in the scrap heap and these really highly skilled transient workforce that is oil and gas. The anecdotal evidence from a friend of mine who's out of international recruitment is they're just taking people from Aberdeen at the moment and placing them somewhere else in the oil and gas sector. So it's that idea of how do we ensure that we create the opportunity prior to closing down another sector?
Yeah, really good questions. I asked the same questions myself. Like I say, I don't have a magic bullet to solve that, other than these things about kind of communication and foresighting and confidence and making the training places available. And all of those things are interlinked, you know. And back to the point you made earlier about having that kind of greater clarity, which then feeds through into that investment. But I don't know the detail about how we should be supporting, especially the small and medium enterprises. But it just, like we've already said, you know, it feels like a particular area where support is needed of the right kind.
I think if I go back to when we're talking about investment into the sort of green economy, if you like, and government investment, private investment into the green economy, I think one of the things that seems to be missing to me is how we invest in weaving the green economy into our educational environment before they get to tertiary education, before they get to colleges. How do we highlight the opportunities, as you said? You know, we were hearing the engineers down at Prestwick are getting our £77,000. That's a pretty decent salary, you know, and a long term, you know, electrical engineering is going to be required for life. I don't think that is getting into that sort of we're marketing that well enough into our education environment. So as part of the investment into the green economy, are we considering how we invest into the educational environment to make sure we have the skill set?
Arguably we're not considering it enough. There are initiatives out there. There's lots of initiatives trying to address all sorts of aspects of this. At my university, we did a short project. One of the postdoctoral researchers just went out to the internet, found 100 different initiatives related in some way to the electricity system and the management and attraction of the workforce. How are all these linked up? What are the gaps? How successful are they? There seems to be an absence of that kind of coordination, although I'm told, again, people like Skills Development Scotland and Energy and Utility Skills are on top of that. Getting into the schools and communicating the opportunities, again, it's something, there's one or two initiatives and there's some chat around it. There are schemes to send engineers into the schools and give talks and set up, you know, little kind of games and exercises and a bit of practice. They can have a bit of an impact, and there are summer schools that are offered by universities. But did it have a big enough impact? I'm not really sure. There's another school of thought that says, actually, what we should be doing is teaching the teachers, you know, helping them to understand what the opportunities are. And it's maybe not the careers advisors. It might be the physics teacher or the maths teacher. And getting into primary schools especially and teaching the teachers. So a lot of the teachers in primary schools don't come from a STEM background. So maybe it doesn't come quite so easily. So, you know, what are we doing to support them and kind of get that into that level of education, help, you know, generate some enthusiasm, and then maintaining the enthusiasm. Again, I've read things suggesting that there's a big fall off in enthusiasm in the early days of secondary school. And there's a big kind of cultural challenge there as well, I think, especially around sort of STEM subjects. I don't know, it's not seen as being cool or whatever, and I can give a kind of personal anecdote. Both my daughters have studied STEM subjects. My older one just graduated this summer in electrical and mechanical engineering. She's very proud of that. But it was a key moment for her in school. I think by chance, the teacher of the engineering science, Nat 5, happened to be a woman. And that made a difference, so I understand, to the kind of atmosphere of the class. So there's all sorts of things around that. There's a lot of work to be done. As I say, a lot of work is going on, but it feels a bit fragmented to me.
We do have other business to do this morning. If you could bring your questions to a close.
Got one left.
And for the witnesses not to give such long answers as well.
That would be helpful.
No, these are the answers, actually, that we want to hear. I think, finally, it's just around that. you know, what we as a country, we always pride ourselves in innovation. You know, and probably the answers that are required have not yet been invented, some of them. I mean, I disagree with what my colleague here is, I don't think they have to, you know, contract anything. We just have to decarbonise and encourage that decarbonisation. So, again, back to that educational, you know, piece in terms of needing to invest in our education to create the long-term solutions.
Yeah, I totally agree. Broadly speaking, I think the technologies to enable net zero already exist. They're not all at the similar level of maturity, but it takes a long time for new technologies to emerge from an idea to a lab to a scale-up. It's all there, or it has to be there anyway, but it is all there, albeit there is a need for further innovation to improve the performance, reduce the cost, improve the flexibility, and there's a lot of detail about everything, how everything hangs together. So there is still a need for a significant investment in R&D.
I'll leave it there then.
Colin Smith, did you wish to have a question before we close?
Thanks very much, Convener. The point's been made a couple of times that one of the challenges of the transition is the fact that current wages in oil and gas are often better than the ones in the renewable sector. So I suppose a question for yourself, first of all, Professor Roy. Has the Scottish Fiscal Commission made an assessment of any of those second-order effects of the transition? For example, what is the impact on the wage variations on the public finances?
So one of the challenges, come back to the point about data, one of the challenges that we have is that there isn't a sector that we can look at to say this is oil and gas workers in terms of their tax contribution, in part because we don't know where ultimately their residence is, because you could be working offshore, but actually you live in Glasgow or you live somewhere else in the country. What we have done, though, is that you can isolate out the northeast, and that can give you a rough proxy for the value of the northeast economy more broadly, which isn't just oil and gas, but we think it's a significant proportion of that. But it's the supply chain, and it's also the wider strength of that sector. And that's the analysis that we've done that has shown that there is this kind of income tax premium, if I can call that, between that relative contribution of that region relative to the Scottish average. And one of the issues that we raise around fiscal sustainability is that once you remove that premium, then actually Scottish income tax would be lower than otherwise would have been, which comes to the broad point about saying that what really matters under our fiscal framework is high-value jobs. And oil and gas are high-value jobs, so that matters, that benefits Scotland. So the crucial bit going forward is how do you have high-value jobs in all sectors? But crucially, if we go to transition away from oil and gas, how do you have these high-value jobs that boost our relative income tax position?
Just bring in yourself, Professor Bellamy. I suppose a related matter is the fact that Scotland does have significant economic inequalities. So I'm based down in Dumfries and Galloway, as the lowest paid region in Scotland. The debate around the just transition is around, at the moment, how you maintain that economic premium in the northeast. But actually, for my constituents, maintaining the status quo, frankly, isn't a just transition. So in terms of that drive for renewables, I mean, the argument is we don't build any of these turbines in Scotland, but we put them up all over Dumfries and Galloway. They're not monitored in Dumfries and Galloway. They're monitored from an office in the Central Belt. What evidence is there developing that the transition is actually tackling any of these economic inequalities that we have in Scotland? Are we just transitioning to maintaining the status quo when it comes to the economy?
Well, I mean, Professor Roy can talk more broadly about the economy and all of the various pressures that it faces and how that changes incomes and the distribution between different areas and kind of educational brackets and so on. So the energy transition, the low carbon transition, that's not the only thing that's going on, of course. And I would just kind of refer back to what I was saying earlier about the need for investment anyway and the opportunities that come with that. So perhaps, okay, naturally we'll be comparing one region with another, one future with another. But you know, opportunities in areas like Dumfries and Galloway could be there. I don't know, I haven't looked in detail, and you'll know the area, of course, much better than me. But, you know, the sort of ecosystem services that come from the landscape, what benefits might come from being a part of it being a national park, or how is the agricultural sector going to transition so that actually has potential for extra value in terms of, yeah, the kind of looking after the land, other things like tourism and whatever, what new things come about. Not far from your patch, I think, talk about building a new cable factory for the electricity system. I don't know how far advanced it is, but, wind farms, not popular with everybody, and you don't want to put them everywhere, but they also bring certain kinds of jobs. So there are opportunities, selling those opportunities, attracting the inward investment. Of course, these are things that I know your committee is always concerned about. The just transition, in one sense, I agree with you that it isn't only about jobs in one place. A just transition is about, I think, more broadly, it does include those things about jobs in one sector and versus another sector, how things are changing in terms of employment. It's also about the overall impacts of a low-carbon economy, and the fair share of the costs and the benefits across society. So that includes things like, what are your energy bills for anybody across the country, regardless of where you live? What affects the cost of that energy? What affects the cost of you getting around? But it's also got to be just and fair for future generations. So it just makes the discussion much more difficult when there are immediate challenges and potential hardships and uncertainties, which we try our best to minimise and manage. But having in mind also that we have to deliver justice and fairness for future generations in terms of managing the impact of climate change and reducing the extent of it.
I don't know if Professor Roy's got any comment on that. Those inequalities.
Yeah, so I think you're right. I mean, but one of the things I think we need to do is put some of this in context, and we've touched a bit on terms of labour market opportunities in there. But if you look at the most recent data, I think Fraser Allen to talk about 13,500 jobs being in renewable technologies. There's 2 million people employed in the private sector in Scotland. So one of the big things that we need to think about as well is actually where the future opportunities that are going to come in our economy more broadly, where these opportunities and businesses are operating in a low carbon world. And Professor Bell talked about some things around the broader sectors in there, but it's the opportunities in sustainable tourism, it's the opportunities for people to work remotely in general sectors in the economy. And so it doesn't just have to be about renewable jobs or low carbon energy jobs in regions. It's actually about the broader success of the economy more generally, where we need to match up the skills and the opportunities. And the flip side of that is
high jobs. I mean, yeah. Some of the sectors you've mentioned so far, both mentioned tourism, hugely important to a rural economy. Yeah. But don't say pay the same as an aircraft engineer, for example. Yeah. So how you then get the high-paid, high-quality jobs into those areas is a challenge.
Increasingly, if you look at things like sustainable tourism and food and drink, that drive to quality rather than volume is leading to higher wages in there. And it's not to say that everyone's going to be paid exactly what an offshore engineer is paying, for very good reasons, given the nature of the job in there. But my general point is, part of the conversation, I think, has to be about the transition is how do you create high-value jobs in Scotland more generally, at the same time as thinking about the transition to net zero? Because that gets into the skills base that we have in our economy. Because one of the things that we know is our labour market is changing. I mean, you're from Dumfries and Galloway. The demographic ageing in Dumfries and Galloway is a huge issue. So how do you support people to transition to work longer, but also attract younger people to the area? And that gets back to reasons about why you might want to live and work in a job in Dumfries and Galloway relative to being in a city. So how do you then nurture the skills system, the education system, all of those things to attract people to an area? So I think the conversation has to be broadened out beyond simply being high-value jobs and low-carbon energy, to actually a broader conversation about how do we create high-value jobs in the Scottish economy. And that's where, again, I think the opportunities, particularly for more rural areas, are really significant.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of this morning's session. And thank you to Professor Roy and Professor Bell for their evidence this morning. I now move into private session.